5 minutes. Ξεκινάμε. Dear colleagues, good evening. With great pleasure and honor, I welcome you in Athens and in the RawMat 2021 conference. I'm Dr. Evangelos Tzamos, Managing Director of the RawMat Innovation Cluster, and I will be your host for this evening. We have a lot of very interesting presentations, so without further ado, I would like to call the Chairman of the RawMat 2021 Scientific Committee, Professor Athimos Xenidis, for his welcome speech. Dr. Xenidis, the stage is yours.
Thank you very much, Dr. Tzamos. First of all, I would like to welcome all of you for coming here. I also to thank all the participants, either physically or remotely attending this conference. This conference, just a minute, την παρουσίαση. Ah, okay. This conference has been scheduled, just a few things about the history of this conference. Has been, the idea for the organization started in 2019, aiming at the revival of mineral wealth conferences that were held every 3 years. I think all of them in Athens, and the last one was in 2000, in the year 2000. And from that time up to now, there was not actually any conference related to the scientific part of the mineral resources. But on the contrary, there were some conferences, one-day conferences, related to the political and strategic aspects of the mineral wealth. This idea has been approved immediately by the Technical Chamber of Greece, and thank you very much for that, and the School of Mining and Metallurgical Engineering of the National Technical University of Athens. These two organizations, together with the GrowMat Innovation Cluster for Raw Materials, that has been recently funded by the Greek Support Program, are the main organizers. RawMat was initially planned to be held in year 2020, but due to the COVID-19 pandemic, it was moved to 2021, to now. You can see here in the previous slide, it was a spot, just a minute, because I have done some mistakes here. You can see here the proceedings of that conference, the last conference of 2000. It was in Greek, the first page of the proceedings. And the main organizers, soon envisioned an international conference instead of a national one on the raw materials and circular economy, focusing on the technological developments and future challenges. We have invited all the organizations, institutes, associations, universities, directly or indirectly involved in the raw materials value chain to co-organize the event. I'm happy to say that the vast majority of them have accepted the invitation to act as co-organizers. And this is the list of co-organizers. We can see here we have the Ministry of Environment and Energy, the Greek Association of Mining Enterprises, the Hellenic Survey for Geology and Mineral Exploration, the Geotechnical Chamber of Greece, the Geological Society of Greece, the School of Mineral Resources Engineering of the Technical University of Crete, the Department of Geology of both the University of Athens and the University of Patras, the University of West Macedonia, the Department of Mineral Resources Engineering, the Department of Chemistry of the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki, the Laboratory of Metallurgy of the University of Patras, and the Institute of Petroleum Resources in Crete. So, a few words about the subject. Why raw materials and why circular economy? It is obvious that raw materials are strongly connected with the development of countries and the prosperity of the Earth's population. They are used everywhere in our daily life. They can be metals, minerals, but also other materials such as wood, rubber, etc. The majority of the raw materials are mined, while recycling and recovery from waste and end products has only recently started playing an important role. In Greece, the extractive sector itself is very important for the national economy, since it represents 3% of annual GDP, 5% of total exports, and a turnover of around 2.3 million euros. At this point, I would like to refer that the raw material sector is not only that. We have to calculate also the turnover coming from recycling companies, for metallurgical companies, and these numbers are much more the situation of with raw material has changed dramatically because there are modern requirements and challenges in strategic areas. The digital industry, aeronautics, the structural changes in energy, all these have radically changed the map of the materials, not only in terms of the of their quantities, but also in terms of the specific minerals that mined and extracted in specific countries. We can see in the map, it's a very well-known map illustrating the evolution of raw materials, the number of raw materials and their quantity throughout the last four centuries. We can see how many elements are required in our century, and this happens because of the new technologies, new systems that need to be constructed, and as we will see in the following slides. Let's take the example of a vehicle. If you have a car, which is a conventional car, then you need some elements like iron, first of all, carbon, molybdenum, aluminum, vanadium, magnesium. But if you see a car that is going to be electric one, then you need different elements, but also their quantities is different. So, if we want to have, let's say, in electric cars, the electric motors has to be constructed by permanent magnets. And to do that, you need rare earth elements. And from the other point of view, the batteries need nickel, cobalt, lithium, phosphorus, graphite, and many other elements. And these elements are characterized as technological elements and need specific effort in order to be produced. Also for copper, for example, a conventional car, an electric car needs 3 to 4 times more copper than a conventional car. So the situation changes dramatically, and this is not the only example we can see here. Πού στοχεύω. Δεν δουλεύει αυτό. Α, οκ. Νο. Maybe It ran out of battery, maybe. Εντάξει, αυτό πατάω, αυτό πατάω. Okay, so let's take the example of wind turbines. They need, first of all, rare earth elements also for their motors, the electric generators. They also need some other elements, like nickel, cobalt, all the elements are there, apart from the conventional elements like aluminium and so on. The similar situation is with solar panels, which are not there, here. Okay. Oh. Okay. We can see here that we have several metals. They have gallium, selenium, tellurium, but also the conventional metals, silver, aluminum, etc. Proceeding, there are several examples to see how the situation changes, and we need much more elements, different elements than the conventional ones, and we need them at huge quantities. No. Smartphones. All of us know that smartphones need 15 different metals to be manufactured in order to be small in size, lightweight, and characterized by advanced functionalities. The World Bank predicts that the demand for metals and minerals will increase mainly due to the technology developments, population growth, and the level of prosperity, and in proportion to ambition for climate change control. On the other hand, OECD predicts that the use of raw materials worldwide will be doubled by 2060, and the use of metals in the same period will increase by 150%. So the safe supply of countries with raw materials, in particular some of them, that are important for cutting-edge technologies, is in the top of their strategic priorities to ensure their industrial production, technological superiority, and job security. In the past, a few words about the European Union and how the European Union addresses the problem of raw materials. In the past, European Union relied on the supply of raw materials from third countries, with domestic production being limited to very low levels. However, this strategy changed dramatically in the last decades, since it was realized that there are significant supply risks for several elements, given that their production is restricted to a few countries, mainly China. The critical raw materials of high technological importance and high supply risk have been identified, and a list has been released with elements such as raw earth elements, germanium, phosphorus, scandium, cobalt, graphite, lithium in the top positions.
Professor, let me remind you the time limit. Time limitation.
Okay, but this session is
5 minutes.
Relatively. Okay, thank you very much. So, another issue is the Green Deal. The Green Deal requires new ecological and efficient energy production and storage systems, new modern fuels, and hydrogen-based reducing agents. We have to know we do not have only problem with energy. Carbon is not only for energy production. It is needed for metals production as a reducing agent. So this, the Green Deal, needs much more critical raw materials, such as rare earth elements and so on. This whole framework places raw materials in a prominent position in the framework of European and national strategies. I would like to refer here the European Innovation Partnership and the European Raw Materials Alliance. So the question is, how all these elements can be produced to cover the future demands? Of course, it is obvious that someone would say that, okay, the exploration of new ore bodies is a logical reply. But from the other hand, we have the transition from linear to circular economy, from where we can, apart from the proper design of the products in order to last for longer, we have the reuse and recycling of materials and the valorization of waste and byproducts. These actions may reduce the need for renewable primary resources, thus contributing to a resilient raw material supply. And the other question is, do we have mature technologies in order to extract these minerals in one or the other way? The answer is not always yes. For this reason, European Commission funds research programs, also the EIT raw materials does the same, in order to find new technologies for raw materials extraction. So I will proceed very quickly on this because the time is almost over. The topics of the conference, you know all the topics of all the conference. I will focus on innovative exploration methods, innovative processes for exploiting either the ores or the waste or the end-of-life products, like batteries, like magnets, and so on. The valorization of waste, which is very important, the decarbonation of industrial processes, and of course, the sustainability strategy and education. So behind each, any effort, any event, there are the people. In this case, there are several people that have been involved for the preparation of this conference. We have the three co-chairs and the organizing committee and the scientific committee. All of them have worked together without any problems, without any, even the last delays. And apart from them, we have the plenary and keynote speakers and their organizing secretariat that started early enough, and they will continue working after this conference for the preparation of all the pending issues. And I would say a few words about the sponsors. We have several sponsors. Thank you very much for the support of the industry, of the enterprises to our effort. First of all, the platinum sponsor is the aluminum and copper industry, El Valhalcor, the Mytilineos group, the aluminum of Greece, and the Promethea. All of them are going to have a presentation from their representatives. And apart from that, we have the gold sponsor, Elas Gold, Hellenic Minerals, Geocycle, it is a part of Iraklis Group, Imeris, the silver sponsor, Titan and National Power Company, and bronze sponsor, Aegean Perlice, Echmes and Eco Efficiency, Grecian Magnesite, Hellenic Halivuria, Larco, Nordment, Polyeco, Sambo, and the Research Committee of the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki. And of course, apart from them, we have the supporters, several supporters. I will say all their names: Ergasis, Mathios Refractories, MapTech, COST, CRC, Metallogic, Horizontas, Vitex, Tracon, and Monolithos. And a few more words. I would like to say that this conference is a hybrid conference. Thank you very much again for your participation, either in a physical way or remotely. I should say at this point that the protocols have changed recently, so many colleagues, many scientists who have programmed to be here they have not managed to do that. And the final statement that I strongly believe that this conference will be finally a successful conference. I want to think that many of you will have pleasant memories, useful memories from this conference at its end. Thank you very much again for coming here, and I hope you a nice continuation of this session.
I would now like to call to the stage Professor Andreas Boudouvis, the Rector of the National Technical University of Athens.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I will try to squeeze my talk, but there is a limit to compressibility of it. Dear government officials, wherever you are joining this conference from, dear President of the Technical Chamber of Greece, the General Assembly of Technical Chamber, dear chairpersons of scientific and professional organizations and sportsmen representatives, dear distinguished guests, dear Dean, speakers, and colleagues from the National Technical University of Athens and other universities, ladies and gentlemen, before I proceed with my talk, I need to mention a significant loss. The passing away a couple of days ago of a prominent member of the community of the National Technical University of Athens, the former rector and professor emeritus of the School of Civil Engineering, Themistocles Xanthopoulos. He served as a rector from 1997 to 2003, and he left behind a great legacy. I welcome you all to the RawMat 2021, the International Conference on Raw Materials and Circular Economy. I am honored and glad to do that as the rector of NTUA for two main reasons. First, NTUA is the main co-organizer of this event through the School of Mining and Metallurgical Engineering. And this conference brings together academia, industry, enterprises, and professional bodies. Second, as far as I know, this is the first large-scale conference organized by NTUA which crosses, while obeying rules, of course, the previous hard pandemic borderline, and this makes us all optimistic that we are entering a new normal. The organizing committee deserves our applause for setting up this conference. Our applause, I said. For coping with the serious adversities of the pandemic and managing to make it hybrid with a substantial percentage of in-person attendance. Anthime, congratulations for the big effort and my best wishes for the smooth continuation of this conference. No doubt that the conference addresses a crucial interplay, that of mining of raw materials on one side and on the other side, of circular economy and net zero carbon emissions, net zero in short. This link is not widely known and appreciated, namely that moving to net zero inevitably means more mining. The public will need to accept greater mining activity if the world is to meet the challenge of going green. I will share some thoughts with you about that, and I refer to an excellent commentary by Richard Harrington of the Department of Earth Sciences in the Natural History Museum in London, which was published in Nature Materials last month. Resource experts say the current supply of various metals and minerals cannot support a global economy producing net zero. Extraction rates have to be raised, at least in the short term. Eventually, large-scale recycling should be able to satisfy the demand for key commodities such as lithium, as already mentioned by Anthimos. New mining initiatives are often met with resistance because of the negative impacts they can have on the wider environment and on health. And some activities have drawn particular ire because they have become associated with labor abuses. So it is that an urgent discussion needs to get going on where and how the inevitable new extraction is practiced. The public seems that they do not understand yet the full implications of the Green Revolution. Electric car is a key issue. The future of electric cars may depend on mining some critically important metals, even and mainly on the ocean floor. In relation to that, the demand is soaring for cobalt, an essential ingredient in batteries and abundant in rocks on the seabed. Governments around the world are busy setting targets to transform their economies so they no longer contribute warming gases to the atmosphere, or more correctly, have a net zero contribution. This will mean phasing out the internal combustion engine and dramatically increasing renewable energy technologies such as wind and solar. Some countries, UK among them, want all new cars to go electric from 2030, replacing the estimated 1.4 billion internal combustion engine vehicles worldwide would need 8 million tons of cobalt, 10 million tons of lithium carbonate, 80 million tons of copper, and that's before the metal and mineral requirements of all the wind turbines and solar farms are considered. Estimates are, according to Harrington, that by 2035, we will have sorted out a good source of recycled metal. Therefore, we need to continue some mining. But hopefully, by 2050, we would have built a truly circular economy so that most, if not all, of what we need can come from metals that we have already mined and are already being used in products and technologies. So, how should the increased mining be done, and where should it be done? These are tough questions. Consider the trend in extending mining to the seafloor. Some companies say they would not accept any product from the ocean because of the damage this might do to the marine environment. At the moment, metals and minerals are often sourced in countries that are not the main consumers of these commodities. A case in point is graphite. Two-thirds of the total world annual production comes from mining China, and a similar proportion of the world's cobalt comes out from the Republic of Congo. One might assume that European countries may wish to do the required mining closer to home. This would at least give them greater security of supply and control over those aspects, such as waste, worker exploitation, etc., of the global extraction industry that have seriously damaged the reputation of this particular industry. Another big issue seems to be the lead times, since it takes a decade or more from finding material to actually mining the stuff. Another crucial thing is not just about mines, it's the whole supply chain. So even once you have mined your lithium, you have still got to go through all the refining, all the chemical treatments to get to the point where you are making batteries. These are challenges as well as tremendous opportunities calling for rethinking of priorities, for interdisciplinary research, academia-industry synergies, government initiatives, and even for reshaping of engineering curricula. Times are calling for all of us, certainly the National Technical University of Athens, and most importantly, the School of Mining and Metallurgical Engineering, to move forward in directions which I'm sure will be highlighted in this conference. I wish you the best for a productive conference. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Poudouvis. I would now like to call Professor Dimitris Kalliabakos, the Dean of the School of Mining and Metallurgical Engineering from the National Technical University of Athens.
distinguished guests, dear colleagues, dear friends, ladies and gentlemen. It's been more than 20 years since the second conference of the Greek mineral wealth, when our sector gathered, discussed, and exchanged ideas about the subject. It's been a long time. But this event, the RawMat 2021, is much more than a necessary meeting long overdue. The event is characterized by two additional and vital things. The first one is that having its focus on the Greek raw material sector puts the subject at the appropriate level, the international one. So we are very happy that acknowledged and prestigious speakers from other countries are with us, bringing in their valuable experience, which will definitely enrich our discussion. The second thing is that the discussion regarding the prospects of our country's mineral wealth is taking place in the right context. The circular economy, the main target not only in the EU countries, but also worldwide. Without doubt, the organizing committee deserves all the credit for this effort, especially Professor Anthimos Xenidis, the heart and soul of this conference, who has worked tirelessly to overcome the problems of the current situation with the COVID-19 pandemic in order to ensure a successful and fruitful conference. Ladies and gentlemen, we live in a world that changes very fast. Our duty is to recognize what remains unchanged and what things are changing so that we adapt. One thing is certain. The demand for raw materials will be constantly increasing. The mix of raw materials will be different than a century or even 20 years ago, but the demand curve will continue to steeply rise. You may think that if we put a brake to some nonsense parts of modern life, such as the craziness of consumerism, in the developed countries, we will end up in a more rational way of raw materials consumption. There is definitely some truth in this. On the other hand, if we focus on the developing countries, we will see a completely different situation. According to the World Health Organization and UNICEF, almost 2 billion people lack drinking water at home, and more than 4 billion don't have access to basic sanitary infrastructure. Moreover, what about energy poverty? Look at this figure. In the Middle Ages, people in Europe had a daily energy consumption of 24 kilowatt hours. 24. Today, the average daily energy consumption in India is still just 19 kilowatt hours. The confrontation of these social problems alone would require huge amounts of raw materials. Actually, a more just world with a focus to the basic needs of the majority of people presumes a big shift in raw material demand. What is different? What is changing? I will briefly outline the most important changes that would affect our sector. The realization of the idea that raw materials are finite and the time when these would be exhausted is approaching fast in the modern societies. The idea. Of course, this is the fundamental driving force behind the concept of circular economy. Consequently, for example, metallurgy should turn its focus on wastes and raw materials recovery from waste. On the other hand, this drives mining at the extremes to the most difficult and hostile environments on Earth, like the bottom of the oceans, the Arctic areas, etc., even to extraterrestrial mining, not as science fiction this time, but as planned effort within the foreseeable future. Another thing that we should take as granted is that the environment of our planet is at a critical state. Climate change, as a result of man-made activity, is under portas. This, by no means, should be understood as just paying a little more attention to pollution problems. Raw material sector, the heaviest industrial sector on Earth, should change its whole mindset by giving environmental protection equal status in the classic dipole of priorities, safety and financial efficiency. This, in return, requires a change in the way we think, a change in our methodology, in our tools, even in the way we measure the results of our work. Concerning the most promising and undergoing fourth international revolution, we should be ready, because as it has happened in all previous industrial revolutions, many of the new things that this revolution brings would be first tested in our sector. Why is that? Because we fulfill the most urgent needs of humanity. Because scarcity of raw materials leads, as we said, to the extremes, and only the latest technological achievements could be efficient to such a difficult endeavor. For example, unmanned transportation, which is constantly in the limelight recently, will definitely start its real life and test its limits in mining, as it already happens. Also, the fourth industrial revolution will be more than ever a materials revolution. The potential for developing materials with amazing characteristics is huge. We should not forget that raw material sector consists the first link of every production chain. Therefore, we should be ready to respond to these requirements and win the bet. One thing is sure, only those who will shape the fourth industrial revolution would be its leaders. This fact points out the role of the curricula of mining and metallurgical schools. Our school, having a brand new curriculum with over 2/3 of its courses thoroughly changed in order to adapt to the fourth revolution challenges, with confidence emanating from its history and our contribution to the development of our country, faces the future with optimism. In this effort, we understand all the other entities of our sector, academic, professional, industrial, as valuable allies in a common fight. With these final words, I would like once more to warmly welcome you to the RawMat 2021 conference and wish you to enjoy a successful and fruitful conference.
Thank you very much, Professor Kalliabakos. Now I would like to call Mr. Nikolaos Milis, who is the President of Assembly Presidium of the Technical Chamber of Greece. Mr. Milis.
Κυρίες και κύριοι, με ιδιαίτερη χαρά καλωσορίζουμε και εμείς εκ μέρους του Τεχνικού Επιμελητηρίου Ελλάδος το Διεθνές Συνέδριο για τις Πρώτες Ύλες και για την Κυκλική Οικονομία που θα διεξαχθεί, που ξεκινάει σήμερα και θα τελειώσει σε 9 Σεπτεμβρίου εδώ στην Αθήνα. Η θεματολογία, όπως αναφέρεται, εστιάζεται σε θέματα έρευνας, εξόρυξης, επεξεργασίας και εκμετάλλευσης πρώτων υλών, ενέργειας, διαχείρισης περιβάλλοντος και αξιοποίησης παραπροϊόντων και αποβλήτων, καθώς επίσης και στις νέες και καινοτόμες τεχνολογικές εξελίξεις που σχετίζονται με το κλάδο των πρώτων υλών και βέβαια την κυκλική οικονομία. Σκοπός του συνεδρίου, όπως αναφέρεται, είναι να συγκεντρώσει και να φέρει σε επαφή επιστήμονες, στελέχη εταιριών και φορείς λήψης αποφάσεων, προκειμένου να μοιραστούμε, να μοιραστείτε όλοι εδώ, απόψεις και γνώσεις σε σχέση με τις προκλήσεις, τις ευκαιρίες και τις σύγχρονες τάσεις, τις εφαρμογές και εξελίξεις στις ορυκτές πρώτες ύλες. Το συνέδριο απευθύνεται βέβαια στη διεθνή επιστημονική κοινότητα, στους παραγωγικούς φορείς, στη δημόσια διοίκηση και την κοινωνία με στόχο τη διάχυση ερευνητικών αποτελεσμάτων, τεχνολογικών επιτευγμάτων και γνώσης, ενώ ταυτόχρονα συνιστά μια πολύ σημαντική ευκαιρία για τη διεθνή προβολή των φορέων και των εταιριών που δραστηριοποιούνται στον τομέα των πρώτων υλών. Το συνέδριο διοργανώνεται βέβαια από τη Σχολή Μηχανικών Μεταλλίων Μεταλλουργών του Εθνικού Μετσοβίου Πολυτεχνείου, το Τεχνικό Επιμελητήριο της Ελλάδος και τον Συνεργατικό Σχηματισμό Καινοτομίας για τις Ορυκτές Πρώτες Ύλες, RawMat. Πολύ λίγες κουβέντες από τη δική μας την πλευρά σε σχέση με τις ορυκτές πρώτες ύλες και την κυκλική οικονομία. Η Ελλάδα, όπως γνωρίζουμε, είναι πλούσια σε ορυκτές πρώτες ύλες, η μεταλλευτική αξία των οποίων υπολογίζεται σε περίπου 80 δισεκατομμύρια ευρώ. Ο κλάδος έχει εξαγωγές στο 75% της παραγωγής του. Μπορεί και πρέπει τα επόμενα χρόνια να διπλασιάσει τη συμβολή του στο ακαθάριστο εθνικό προϊόν, από 3,4% που είναι σήμερα στο 7%. Και τις θέσεις εργασίας, 100.000 θέσεις άμεσες και έμεσες που είναι σήμερα, μπορούν δυνητικά να φτάσουν στις 200.000. Η αξιοποίηση του ορυκτού πλότου της χώρας πρέπει να γίνει με πλήρη βέβαια εφαρμογή των αυστηρότερων περιβαλλοντικών προδιαγραφών. Αρκεί να αναφέρω, μέχρι το 2050, οι πράσινες ενεργειακές τεχνολογίες θα χρειαστούν 500% περισσότερο γραφίτη, λίθιο, κοβάλτιο, 200% περισσότερο ίνδιο και βανάδιο, 100% παραπάνω νικέλιο και πάνω από 4 εκατομμύρια τόνους χαλκού. Η εθνική λοιπόν βιομηχανική στρατηγική οφείλει να αντιστρέψει την ανεπεξέργαστη εξαγωγή ορυκτών πρώτων υλών που στη συνέχεια επεξεργασμένες επανεισάγονται από τρίτες χώρες ως ενεργειακές και κλιματικές τεχνολογίες. Με ποιους τρόπους? Πρώτον, με τη δημιουργία ενός πλαισίου στήριξης και αξιοποίησης των ορυκτών με εγχώρια καθετοποιημένη επεξεργασία και αξιοποίηση μέσω φορολογικών και άλλων κινήτρων, με τη μείωση του ενεργειακού κόστους με ένα σύνολο ρυθμιστικών προβλέψεων και μειώσεων κόστους και βέβαια με την εξατομίκευση των χρεώσεων χρήσης του συστήματος, ώστε να υπάρχουν σαφείς όροι στη συνεισφορά κάθε καταναλωτή στην ευστάθεια του συστήματος. Η χώρα μας, όπως γνωρίζετε πολύ καλά όσοι ασχολείστε με το κλάδο, είναι δεύτερη στον κόσμο στην παραγωγή περλίτη, καλύπτει το 32% της παγκόσμιας παραγωγής. Είμαστε 8η στην παραγωγή μαρμάρων, 3η στον κόσμο στην παραγωγή μπετονίτη, καλύπτουμε το 7,5% της παγκόσμιας παραγωγής, 9η στον κόσμο στην παραγωγή μαγνησίτη, 13η στην παραγωγή νικελίου, καλύπτει βέβαια το 49% της παραγωγής στην Ευρώπη και 6η στην Ευρώπη επίσης στην παραγωγή αλουμινίου, μία από τις 10 πρώτες στον κόσμο με τα μεγαλύτερα αποθέματα βοξίτη. Την ώρα αυτή λοιπόν η ελληνική κοινωνία, καθώς και η οργανωμένη έκφρασή της, δικαιούται και πρέπει να είναι έγκαιρα ενημερωμένη για την τρέχουσα συνεισφορά της εξορυκτικής βιομηχανίας στην ελληνική οικονομία, για το αναπτυξιακό δυναμικό της, καθώς επίσης και για τους ανασταλτικούς παράγοντες στην ανάπτυξή της. Ωστόσο, για να καταστεί κάτι τέτοιο εφικτό, έχει αναγνωριστεί μια σειρά κρίσιμων παραμέτρων επιτυχίας. Πολύ συνοπτικά είναι η παρακάτω. Η πλήρης εφαρμογή μιας εθνικής πολιτικής αξιοποίησης των ορυκτών πρώτων υλών. Η ασφάλεια δικαίου. Ασφάλεια δικαίου από τον επενδυτή μέχρι αυτόν ο οποίος δραστηριοποιείται και αυτόν ο οποίος έχει μια πρωτοβουλία και μια πρώτη ιδέα. Ασφάλεια δικαίου για όλους. Οι απαραίτητες χωροταξικές ρυθμίσεις για την εξασφάλιση και την αξιοποίηση των ορυκτών πόρων. Η δημιουργία, αφού εξασφαλίσουμε το προηγούμενο που σας είπα, και αποτελεσματική λειτουργία ενός παρατηρητηρίου για την εφαρμογή του χωροταξικού σχεδιασμού της χώρας. Η αποτελεσματική αδειοδότηση νέων εξορρυκτικών έργων ή επεκτάσεων των υπαρχόντων και βέβαια σταθερό φορολογικό πλαίσιο για τις επιχειρήσεις. Σχετικές επιστημονικές μελέτες, φίλες και φίλοι, αποδεικνύουν πως η οικονομική μεγένθηση και η περιβαλλοντική υποβάθμιση σχετίζονται άμεσα. Το αποτύπωμα των υλικών αγαθών, το λεγόμενο ακαθάριστο εγχώριο προϊόν και οι εκπομπές αερίων του θερμοκηπίου έχουν αυξηθεί ραγδαία και παράλληλα στην πάροδο των τελευταίων χρόνων. Και ενώ η αύξηση του πληθυσμού ήταν η κύρια αιτία της αυξανόμενης κατανάλωσης της περίοδου από το 1970 μέχρι το 2000, Η εμφάνιση μιας εύπορης μεσαίας τάξης υπήρξε ο ισχυρότερος μοχλός αμέσως αργότερα. Επιπλέον, η τεχνολογική ανάπτυξη έχει μέχρι στιγμής συνδεθεί με αυξημένη κατανάλωση παρά το αντίστροφο. Εάν λοιπόν, φίλες και φίλοι, η οικονομική μεγέθυνση δεν μπορεί να αποσυνδεθεί από την πίεση στους φυσικούς πόρους, μήπως η επαναχρησιμοποίησή τους εντός της οικονομίας είναι εν τέλει η λύση? Πράγματι, οι πολιτικές κυκλικής οικονομίας, μεταξύ άλλων, αποσκοπούν στη βελτίωση της διαχείρισης των αποβλήτων, στην επαναχρησιμοποίηση και στην ανακύκλωση υλικών. Όμως και εδώ οι μελέτες δείχνουν πως σε κλίμακα ολόκληρης της οικονομίας μόνο το 12% των υλικών που εισραίουν στην Ευρωπαϊκή Ένωση ανακυκλώνονται. Άρα λοιπόν το μέλλον είναι μπροστά μας και οι προκλήσεις επίσης είναι μπροστά μας για να τις διατρέψουμε. Και βέβαια κάτι τελευταίο, ο ρηκτός πλούτος, κυκλική οικονομία, ζητήματα εδώ στην ελληνική επικράτεια απολιγνητοποίησης, δίκαιης μετάβασης, τα έχετε ακούσει. Είμαστε όλοι κοινωνοί των εξελίξεων οι οποίες αυτή τη στιγμή λαμβάνουν χώρα και στην Δυτική Μακεδονία και στην Πελοπόννησο. Με τη δική μας σειρά και τη δική μας συνεισφορά, αυτό το οποίο έχουμε να πούμε είναι ότι πρέπει η ελληνική πολιτεία να ακούσει τις τοπικές κοινωνίες, θα πρέπει να ακούσει τους επιστημονικούς φορείς, τα συμπεράσματα που θα τεθούν και στο Διεθνές Συνέδριο εδώ σήμερα και να πετύχουμε το μέγιστο δυνατό αποτέλεσμα. Οι προκλήσεις είναι μπροστά μας και πραγματικά θα κριθούμε αν τις αντιμετωπίσουμε με την αισιοδοξία και την αποτελεσματικότητα την οποία θα έπρεπε να έχουμε. Σας ευχαριστώ πάρα πολύ.
Thank you very much, Mr. Millis. Now, the next presentation is from me. I will have a short pre-recorded in order to avoid any unexpected COVID situation events that might have occurred regarding the GrowMat Innovation Cluster.
Dear colleagues, I would like to provide you with a brief introduction of the Greek Raw Materials Innovation Cluster, GrowMat, which is one of the three core organizers of the RawMat 2021 conference. In the beginning, I would like to provide some insights regarding clusters for those of you who are not familiar with the term. So, what is an innovation cluster? An innovation cluster is an organized structure formed by enterprises and research bodies with direct or indirect activities in the same field which promote innovation. What is the GrowMat Innovation Cluster? The GrowMat Innovation Cluster focuses on activities related to the Greek raw materials value chain. GrowMat has four building blocks or pillars: the facilitator, the members, administration, and networking. First pillar, the facilitator. Eco Resources, a Greek knowledge-based startup company, has the role of GrowMat's facilitator. Our first initiative was to form a robust and representative team of founding partners. We then built on existing knowledge, while at the same time we are seeking for funding opportunities to implement innovative ideas in the field of raw materials and also attract new members to expand the GrowMat cluster. Our constant goal is to strengthen the cluster, meet future needs and challenges, and last but not least, ensure a dynamic collaboration between industry and research bodies. Eco Resources formulates the general directions, vision, and strategy of GrowMat in terms of the preparation and implementation of a joint action plan for its current members and ensures, of course, mutual benefits for all its members. Second pillar, the GrowMat members. Our members comprise an experienced group of enterprises and universities, namely GM Perlites, Eco Efficiency, GeoElas, Grecian Magnesite, Hellas Gold, Hellenic Mines, Lava Mining and Quarrying, Mathios Refractories, Mytilineos Metallurgical Business Unit, North Aegean Slopes, Stone Group, the Laboratory of Metallurgy from the National Technical University of Athens, and the Laboratory of Chemical and Environmental Technology of Aristotle University of Thessaloniki. Third pillar, the administration. Each company member of GrowMat has appointed two representatives to the cluster. All those representatives constitute the General Assembly of GrowMat, from which the steering committee is formed. In addition, The Scientific Board comprises distinguished members of the Academic Society and members of the R&D departments of the companies. The Scientific Board is divided into specific thematic sections related to raw material science and technology. The Scientific Board of GrowMat operates under the Scientific Officer, and its members are selected after the recommendation of the Scientific Officer and the approval of the GrowMat's Steering Committee. Fourth pillar, networking. GrowMat is currently attempting to build an outward-looking approach in order to attract raw material companies and form strong partnerships through clustering and networking in the field. We adapt an organized structure, vision, and strategy. In addition, GrowMat is not just a network of companies operating in the raw material sector, but a dynamic environment that will promote entrepreneurship and deliver targeted and value-added outcomes. In essence, our goal is for GrowMat to become a strong brand name of quality services and products. The objectives of GrowMat under the EU Broad Innovation Strategy are the mobilization of a significant number of stakeholders, the formation of a well-defined framework for cooperation between them, the constant communication and interaction of its members, the encouragement for the creation of new enterprises, the introduction of participating SMEs in an acceleration phase, the establishment of innovative research as a lever of influence on the economy of regions, and the formulation of an international strategy. Before finishing this short presentation, I would like to provide some statistics regarding the RawMat 2021 conference. The Scientific Committee consists of 113 members from 26 different countries. 257 papers have been submitted from 718 unique authors coming from 42 different countries. 269 presentations and talks will take place, among them 7 plenary talks, 22 keynote lectures, and 240 paper presentations. Out of these 240 presentations, 190 will be oral presentations and 50 will be posters. Dear attendees of RawMat 2021, the GrowMat Innovation Cluster officially welcomes you to the RawMat 2021 conference. Ahead of us, there are 4 particularly interesting days of presentations and opinions exchange on raw materials. Enjoy the conference, enjoy Athens. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We are already 25 minutes over timed. So the next speech, I think it's also a recorded video from Mr. Athanas Georgiadis, who is the Minister for Development and Investment.
Ευχαριστώ πάρα πολύ την πρόσκληση και λυπούμαι που ο φόρτος εργασίας δεν μου επιτρέπει να παρευρίσκομαι ζωντανά και να συμμετέχω ενεργά στη συζήτηση. Ένα συνέδριο για τις πρώτες ύλες και την κυκλική οικονομία, τις τεχνολογικές εξελίξεις και τις προκλήσεις του μέλλοντος για όλο αυτό νομίζω είναι σήμερα περισσότερο επίκαιρο παρά ποτέ. Και λόγω της κλιματικής αλλαγής, των συνεπειών της και της συνέχειας και της συνέπειας που έχει για μας η ορθή χρήση των πρώτων υλών, αλλά και διότι η μεγάλη αύξηση της τιμής των πρώτων υλών παγκοσμίως, όπως παρατηρείται μετά την πανδημία, δημιουργεί πράγματι πίεση που η ορθή διαχείριση των πόρων θα μπορούσε σε μεγάλο βαθμό να απορροφήσει. Άρα λοιπόν υπό την έννοια αυτή, η μεταστροφή από το γραμμικό μοντέλο στο μοντέλο της κυκλικής οικονομίας είναι μια πολύ μεγάλη πρόκληση για να φτάσουμε στην παραγωγή μιας αλυσίδας αξίας, με το σχεδιασμό προϊόντων από την κατανάλωση, τη διαχείριση αποβλήτων και την αγορά ανακυκλωμένων υλικών. Όλη μας η νέα βιομηχανική στρατηγική εδράζεται πάνω στον στόχο και μπορώ να σας πω ότι τόσο στο νέο ΕΣΠΟ όσο και στο Μείο Ανάκαμψη έχουμε δεσμεύσει και σημαντικούς πόρους για να μπορούμε να οθήσουμε τη βιομηχανική μας παραγωγή προς αυτήν την κατεύθυνση. Αναμένω με αγωνία τα αποτελέσματα της σημερινής ημερίδος και θεσμικά θα συζητήσουμε εδώ στο Υπουργείο για να βρούμε μαζί τις βέλτιστες δυνατές λύσεις. Σας εύχομαι καλή επιτυχία.
The next speaker is Mr. Konstantinos Aravosis, the Secretary General for Natural Environment and Water. I think we have him online.
Thank you very much. I would like to thank you for the invitation and congratulate the organizers for electing this event. It is important to bring together all stakeholders, the academic community, other professionals to share information on raw materials and the perspectives of circular economy. While we are trying to recover from the pandemic and its multiple economic and social consequences, the greatest challenge is to convert this situation into an opportunity and move towards a sustainable, circular, and carbon neutral economy by 2050. The EU has included the transition to circular economy in the European Green Deal, which is the new European agenda for sustainable growth. The shift to circular economy model will reduce pressure on natural resources, contribute to the 2050 climate neutrality target, and it will also reduce pollution and biodiversity loss, while also create new jobs and promote sustainable development. The current linear economic model is based on the extraction, production, use, disposal model, and it is not sustainable anymore. Whatever was considered waste so far can be transformed to raw material for another production process, contributing to the industrial symbiosis. This way, depletion of raw material can be slowed down and environmental pollution and climate change can be restricted. Currently, Greece has set circular economy and our ministry, the Ministry for Environment and Energy, has set circular economy in the core of its development strategy, of its policies, and it recognizes the transition to circularity as a prerequisite for sustainable development and prosperity. As you might know, Greece has now a new national strategy for circular economy. It is based on the new circular economy action plan that has been adopted by the EU in March 2020. And this circular economy plan includes certain actions that in reality is a new framework that will be our plan for the next 4 years. We have, in the meanwhile, at national level, already passed legislation pieces that are related to circular economy. For example, we reviewed the waste management plan. We adopted the new national plan for green public procurement. We voted the law on single-use plastics. And recently, a law for the harmonization of the Greek law with the directives 851, 852, as well as the adjustment of other provisions of waste management. To this end, the General Secretariat of Natural Environment and Water has undertaken the task to coordinate and review a previous action plan for circular economy, and the new action plan harmonized with the new EU action plan includes a series of concrete actions that will be implemented for the period 2021-2025. And in more detail, these concrete time-bound actions include a focus on production, consumption, waste management, and horizontal issues related to governance and administration. And also products and services which are resource intensive and where the potential for circularity is high, such as electronics and ICT, packaging, plastics, textiles, construction and buildings, food, waste and water and so on play a crucial role in this plan. The ministry has set a very ambitious plan in promoting all the aspects of what we call green development, including the waste prevention and waste treatment strategies, moving up to the waste hierarchy pyramid from waste to secondary raw materials and from treatment to no waste generation at all. We are moving to a zero waste society. This is our aim. Recycling is a very extremely important component of circular economy, following reuse, remanufacture, repair. Another important issue is how can products be designed, what we call eco-design, out of waste and processes of reuse as raw materials for making new products. Resources and materials can be recycled, they can be returned back to the economy and they can be used again. What was once considered as waste can become now a valuable resource. Materials from products at the end of the life cycle should be recovered through dismantling and recycling. Reinjecting these materials into the beginning of the product life cycle has the impact of reducing the environmental impact, and they have a high impact on the costs of production. So the market, the European Union single market for recovered waste materials are still underdeveloped on EU level, but while 45% of waste is large companies is a resource, this figure fails to only 25% for SMEs. So there is a huge potential for improvement in the EU and especially in Greece. However, there is a need for common standards and market tools. And there are such tools in the EU action plan, such as common quality standards, common rules on fertilizers, plastic as a recyclable resource, smart design, proper sorting that can increase the recycling rates of plastics and avoid landfill. So we have a great challenge ahead of us. But we must see this also as an opportunity. Through circular economy, we find and we can find a way for the next years, an effective way to promote green growth, boost investments, and in parallel, increase employment and well-being. To this end, we are working towards rebuilding our economy and society in a sustainable way. However, in order to succeed, we need the support of all stakeholders from production, trade, the consumers, and the research community. And I think events like the conference that we are today are very important in order to bring together specialists, scientists that are very specialized in the field, and to hear presentations, useful, practical presentations that we can take into account in our new plan towards circularity and raw materials use, which is something very important in order to have this transfer of our economy to the so much needed circularity. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Aravosis. We now move to our next speaker, Mr. Athanasios Kefalas, who is the president of Greek Mining Enterprises Association. Mr. Kefalas, the stage is yours.
Thank you, Dr. Jamos. Eminent attendees, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends and colleagues. It is a great honor on behalf of the Greek Mining Enterprises Association to welcome you, representatives of the government, public administration, international and in national academia and extractive industry in raw materials 2021. A great event devoted to raw materials and the extractive industry. Our association represents over 85% of the volume produced by the Greek extractive industry. The association was founded almost 100 years ago. Its oldest members dating back to the 19th century and is now home to 30 companies employing directly and indirectly about 12,000 people and fully promoting responsible mining in adherence to the Code of Sustainable Principles as of 2006. The Greek land hosts a wide portfolio of minerals with countless uses in industry and daily life, many of them with leading position in global ranks thanks to some world-class deposits. To highlight this, I indicate that Greece is the fifth global bentonite producer and the European leader, the largest European exporter of magnesite, the global leader in raw perlite production, and so on. It is worth also mentioning that our country is the leading European producer of two critical raw materials, bauxite and magnesite. The extractive industry occupies less than 0.2% of the national surface, of which already more than 100 million square meters have been restored or host already other post-mining land uses. Thanks to these natural resources and the proven business competencies of the Greek mining companies, the domestic extractive industry accounts for more than 3% of the Greek GDP and supports more than 100,000 high-quality jobs, especially in the Greek periphery, which is chronically the more exposed to unemployment. Our industry is strongly extrovert, accounting for 5 to 10, depends if we count or not the fuels, of the Greek exports, is a magnet of foreign investments and executes an average 350 million euros worth of investments per year, sustained even during the financially challenging past decade. Mining proved resilient during the economic crisis. It maintained its infrastructure and employment levels and absorbed to the great extent the economic impact. The mining industry is now ready and eager to contribute to the restart of the Greek economy. The pandemic has been an unprecedented challenge, but our companies rose to it, responded promptly and reprioritized their targets, aiming to protect their human capital and support the local communities as well as the national health system. The key drivers behind this resilience and growth mindset, as well as overall performance, are the exploitation of a rich palette of high-quality deposits, some of them classified as world-class. The deep knowledge of the competitive advantage of all natural resources and the gradual shift of the Greek companies to solution providers instead of raw material producers. logistic advantages thanks to the large coastline and the geographical position of the country. Last but not least, the increase in internationalization, as many of the companies are subsidiaries of large multinational groups or have already established strong presence abroad with joint ventures, mining sites, or distribution channels. Looking forward, the prospects of each big segment of the Greek mining industry now vary. Metallic ores, falling global growth, and the recent developments on energy generation. Industrial minerals growing in line with their value proposition. MALPs rebounding mainly through solution-focused exports. Aggregates being there to support big investments in state infrastructure as well as the private investments. Lignite has to find its way as a security energy resource till 2023, as well as a resource for other non-energy applications. Green Deal is the new bet for the European economy and society, and minerals are key in meeting this challenge, either as a player or as an enabler. A recently published report from the International Energy Agency reveals that in a scenario that means just merely needs the Paris Agreement goals, we require 4 times more minerals for clean energy technologies by 2040. And in a different scenario, we require 6 times more minerals than today. This means that the today's reliance on fossil fuels will be replaced with one on raw materials and mainly minerals, many of which the European Union sources from abroad and for which global competition is becoming increasingly fierce. In this global environment, the extroversion, the overperformance and the proven resilience of the Greek extractive industry could set an example for the required transition to a new growth paradigm for the country. The extractive industry contributes to the stabilization of the Greek economy and eventual growth through the high and increasing export share as well as its international character and ability to attract investments. In this challenging time, the Greek extractive industry adapts to the situation and aims to continuously be a source of competitive advantage of our national economy, but several impediments, administrative or other ways, should be addressed by the state. In this context, RawMat 2021 arrives on time and sets the suitable field to discuss the way forward. I'm confident that the exchange of experience and best practices, the sharing of knowledge and the boost of innovative ideas will enable all of us to cope with the upcoming challenges and pursue growth. Thank you and enjoy RawMat 2021, as well as your staying in Athens for those with physical presence. Thank you again.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kefalas. Now I would like to call Mr. Kostas Troulos from the Innovation Department of the Hellenic Federation of Enterprises, SEV.
Καλησπέρα κύριοι πρόεδροι της Οργανωτικής και της Επιστημονικής Επιτροπής, κυρίες και κύριοι, ευχαριστώ για την πρόσκληση να απευθύνω εκ μέρους του ΣΕΒ, του Συνδέσμου Βιομηχανίας, ένα σύντομο χαιρετισμό στο συνέδριό σας. Επιστημονικά συνέδρια σαν το RawMat 2021 προάγουν τη γνώση για την επιστήμη και επί της ουσίας συμβάλλουν στην ανάπτυξη τεχνολογιών που μπορούν να μεταφερθούν στην αγορά με τη μορφή νέων προϊόντων και υπηρεσιών, ώστε τελικά ερευνητές και startups να μπορέσουν να καινοτομήσουν και να παράγουν πλούτο και για εκείνους και για την κοινωνία και για τη χώρα. Και γι' αυτό είναι εξαιρετικά σημαντικό τέτοιες δραστηριότητες ανάμεσα σε πολλές άλλες, αλλά και ειδικά τέτοιες έτσι, που εστιάζουν βαθιά και στην επιστήμη και τεχνολογία, είναι σημαντικό να αναδεικνύονται. Ο ΣΕΒ πάντοτε υποστήριζε την ανάπτυξη της καινοτομίας και της νεοφυούς επιχειρηματικότητας στην Ελλάδα, είτε αυτή αφορούσε σε οργανική ανάπτυξη επιχειρήσεων, είτε σε συνεργασία έρευνας με βιομηχανία. Όπως και υποστήριζε και υποστηρίζει τη διασφάλιση ενός κατάλληλου ευνοϊκού ρυθμιστικού περιβάλλοντος που θα ενισχύσει το εθνικό οικοσύστημα καινοτομίας. Στην τελική ανάλυση και αναγνωρίζοντας την τεράστια αξία που έχει για το μέλλον και για την αντιμετώπιση των προκλήσεων η καινοτομία, πολλές φορές αυτές τις προκλήσεις δεν μπορούμε καν να τις φανταστούμε πώς θα είναι σήμερα σε 3-5 χρόνια και νομίζω ότι και η πανδημία το κατέδειξε αυτό σαφέστατα. Ο ΣΕΒ έχει θέσει την καινοτομία μέσα στους βασικούς πυλώνες στρατηγικής του. Ανάμεσα σε παραδοσιακούς πυλώνες, όπως είναι η ενίσχυση της βιομηχανικής παραγωγής, η μετάβαση στην πράσινη οικονομία, ο ψηφιακός μετασχηματισμός οικονομίας και επιχειρήσεων, καθώς και η ανάπτυξη γνώσης και δεξιοτήτων και διαβίου μάθησης. Όπως είναι εύκολα αντιληπτό, η καινοτομία διέπει οριζόντια και τους υπόλοιπους πυλώνες της στρατηγικής, γεγονός που την καθιστά βασικό πρόταγμα για μια Ελλάδα αλλιώς. Μια σύγχρονη ψηφιακή, πράσινη Ελλάδα με δύναμή της το ανθρώπινο δυναμικό. Μια Ελλάδα που παράγει και εξάγει σε όλο τον κόσμο και καρπώνεται τα ανάλογα ωφέλη σε όλο της το κοινωνικό φάσμα. Ο ΣΕΒ, λοιπόν, έχει ξεκινήσει μια σειρά επιτυχημένων δράσεων για την ανάπτυξη της καινοτομικής ικανότητας της ελληνικής οικονομίας και επιχειρήσεων ανεξαρτήτως μεγέθους και προπάντων του αποτυπώματος που οραματιζόμαστε να αφήσει η καινοτομία στη χώρα. Ενδεικτικά έτσι και πολύ επιγραμματικά, σημαντικές δράσεις που έχουν γίνει τον τελευταίο χρόνο. Το πρώτο βασικό είναι το Innovation Ready. Το Innovation Ready είναι μια προσπάθεια να φέρουμε μαζί μεγάλες επιχειρήσεις μαζί με startups και ερευνητές spin-offs από τα πανεπιστήμια. Μέσω αυτής της πρωτοβουλίας προβάλλουμε την αξιόλογη καινοτομία που παράγεται στην Ελλάδα από εγχώρια startups και spin-offs και τα διασυνδέουμε με τη βιομηχανία και με τις επιχειρήσεις που θέλουν να ενισχύσουν την καινοτομικότητά τους και να αποκτήσουν περισσότερο εξωστρέφεια. Και αυτό βέβαια βοηθάει νεοφυείς επιχειρήσεις, είτε είναι startups είτε είναι πανεπιστημιακά spin-offs, να αναπτύξουν αναγκαίες για αυτές συνέργειες που αποσκοπούν είτε να ξεπεράσουν το λεγόμενο Valley of Death και να μεγαλουργήσουν στο μέλλον ή να επιτύχουν αποτελεσματικό και γρήγορο scale up των δραστηριοτήτων τους. Το δεύτερο πράγμα που έχει γίνει την τελευταία χρονιά είναι ότι διαπιστώσαμε μια ανεκμετάλλευτη πηγή ανάπτυξης και πλούτου για τη χώρα, η οποία αφορά στην ελληνική διασπορά. Μετρήσαμε ότι στην Αμερική, μόνο στην Αμερική, εταιρείες που έχουν φτιαχτεί από Έλληνες επιχειρηματίες έχουν μια αξία πάνω από 100 δισεκατομμύρια δολάρια. Και έτσι φτιάχτηκε η κοινότητα την οποία ονομάζουμε Innovative Greeks ή στα αρχαία ελληνικά εφευρετικοί Έλληνες ανά τον κόσμο. Και θελήσαμε με έναν πιο δομημένο τρόπο όλοι αυτοί οι άνθρωποι να βρεθούν μαζί, να αρχίσουν να συνεργάζονται και να μπορέσουμε επιτέλους να εκμεταλλευτούμε όλα αυτά τα μεγάλα μυαλά Ελλήνων που έχουμε και οι οποίοι ενδιαφέρονται να βοηθήσουν την ταχύτερη ανάπτυξη της χώρας, του οικοσυστήματος καινοτομίας και της ελληνικής οικονομίας. Έγινε ένα συνέδριο στην αρχή του χρόνου, το οποίο συνέδριο μάζεψε τεράστια, πολύ μεγαλύτερο ενδιαφέρον από ό,τι περιμέναμε, πάνω από 10.000 συμμετέχοντες σε αυτό το συνέδριο, το οποίο το καθιστά ένα από τα μεγαλύτερα events που έχουν γίνει ever στον τομέα αυτό. Και από αυτό το συνέδριο ξεκίνησε, θέλουμε να πιστεύουμε, ένας ενάρετος κύκλος συνεργασίας μεταξύ Ελλήνων της Ελλάδας και Ελλήνων του εξωτερικού. Προσπαθούμε να αξιοποιήσουμε τους Innovative Greeks του εξωτερικού, προβάλλοντας συστηματικά την Ελλάδα μέσα από αυτή την κοινότητα και ως επενδυτικό προορισμό, αλλά και ως προορισμό εργασίας και κατοικίας ψηφιακών ομάδων ανά τον κόσμο. Αναδεικνύουμε με ειδικές καμπάνιες επικοινωνίας το νέο πρόσωπο της Ελλάδας που αλλάζει, τα συγκριτικά πλεονεκτήματα της χώρας και του ανθρώπινου δυναμικού της, του εξαίρετου ανθρώπινου δυναμικού της, καθώς και τους καινοτόμους και επιτυχημένους επιχειρηματίες της. Το τρίτο πράγμα που έχει γίνει την τελευταία χρονιά, αυτό που έχουμε ξεκινήσει στο ΣΕΒ, είναι να κάνουμε τον ΣΕΒ το σπίτι για τις επιχειρήσεις τεχνολογίας και τα startups. Όχι μόνο δηλαδή βαριά βιομηχανία, αλλά και βιομηχανία τεχνολογίας υψηλής. Θεωρούμε ότι είμαστε ένα φυσικό σπίτι σε επίπεδο αξιών και σε επίπεδο οργάνωσης και σε επίπεδο σοβαρότητας. Είμαστε ένας οργανισμός που δίνει πολύ μεγαλύτερη βάση στην ουσία και λιγότερο στην εικόνα. Και αυτές οι εταιρείες οι οποίες συμμετέχουν σε αυτή την κοινότητα είναι αυτής της φιλοσοφίας. Αυτή λοιπόν το τμήμα των μελών, αν θέλετε, του ΣΕΒ, το ονομάζουμε Scale Up Community, έχει ξεπεράσει τα 50 μέλη αυτή τη στιγμή και περιλαμβάνει μερικές από τις πιο γνωστές εταιρείες τεχνολογίας στην Ελλάδα. Εταιρείες που έχουν γράψει πρωτοσέλιδα και που, αν μου επιτρέπετε, έχουν δώσει έτσι μια εθνική περηφάνεια σε πολλούς από εμάς. Τέλος, ως κοινωνικός εταίρος, ο ΣΕΒ υποστηρίζει διάφορες διαβουλευτικές διαδικασίες με εκπροσώπους επιχειρήσεων μελών μας, οι οποίοι γνωρίζουν καλύτερα από όλους τα κλαδικά τους ζητήματα και προκλήσεις, όπως σχετικά πρόσφατο παράδειγμα, τη διαδικασία της επιχειρηματικής ανακάλυψης από τη Γενική Γραμματεία Έρευνας και Καινοτομίας. Θα κλείσω λέγοντας ότι, κοιτώντας παραδείγματα άλλων χωρών, όπως η Σιγκαπούρη, το Ισραήλ, η Εστονία, είναι ξεκάθαρο ότι ο ρόλος της καινοτομίας σε μια οικονομία του δικού μας μεγέθους, έτσι, μπορεί να αλλάξει τη μοίρα της χώρας για τα επόμενα χρόνια. Και εμείς αυτό το έχουμε δει να γίνεται στο ΣΕΒ, όταν το οικοσύστημα της ψηφιακής τεχνολογίας των startups, που λέγεται, ήταν μηδέν η κεφαλοποίηση αυτής της αγοράς ήταν μηδέν πριν από 10 χρόνια και σήμερα ξεπερνάει τα 5 δισεκατομμύρια ευρώ, με περίπου απασχόληση 6.000 ανθρώπων. Τώρα, αν θα τα καταφέρουμε ή όχι, και γιατί όχι, η τεχνολογία και η καινοτομία να αποτελέσουν σημαντικό ποσοστό του ΑΕΠ της χώρας, θα είμαστε όλοι πάρα πολύ ευτυχείς. Για να ξεκινήσουμε και να βλέπουμε μια Ελλάδα αλλιώς. Ευχαριστώ πολύ για τον χρόνο σας. Καλή επιτυχία και δύναμη στο συνέδριο.
Thank you very, very much, Mr. Troulos. I would like now to call to the floor Dr. Petros Koutsovitis. He is an associate professor, assistant professor at the University of Patras, and he is here representing the Geological Society of Greece.
Ladies and gentlemen, honorable participants, on behalf of the Geological Society of Greece, it gives me great pleasure to welcome you to the International Conference on Raw Materials and Circular Economy, RawMat, that aims to provide further knowledge and insights covering a wide range of technological developments and critical issues which are related to the sustainable use of raw materials based on the principles of circular economy. The Geological Society of Greece is pleased to provide its support to this conference, and I bring you the greetings of the President and all the members of the Society's Board to the RawMat Organization and Scientific Committee, to the sponsors for their support, to the keynote speakers, and to all of you who are here today or who will participate through virtual attendance. We are delighted to see that the conference has already achieved in bringing together members of the academic community, engineers, geologists, as well as early stage and senior scientists, along with industry executives, stakeholders, and policymakers that are professionally associated with the broad field of raw materials to exchange ideas and knowledge. I would like to take the opportunity to inform you about the scope and mission of the Geological Society of Greece. It is a 70-year-old nonprofit scientific organization that was founded in 1951, aiming to promote and advance the knowledge and research of topics related to the science of geology. Throughout its history, it has established dedicated scientific committees, allowing its members to communicate and exchange ideas in their respective fields, as well as to further advance their knowledge by having the opportunity to present their research work and findings. This has been accomplished by hosting successful international congresses, scientific meetings, workshops, field trips, and publications in the Bulletin of the Geological Society of Greece, as well as the informative magazine entitled Geonimerosi. In this context, the Society provides a forum for the presentation and dissemination of current knowledge related to the geology of Greece and the adjacent areas to earth scientists and to the Society. In short, the committees include those of engineering geology, geology, mineralogy, and geochemistry, hydrogeology, structural geology and tectonics, paleontology and stratigraphy, geomorphology and environment, geoscience teaching, as well as geological heritage. In a few words, the aims of the Society are to contribute to research, education, and promotion of geological sciences, assist its members, and also anyone who is interested in obtaining information and continuous improvement of their knowledge in the developments of geoscience-related issues. Disseminate the findings and notes provided by geological surveys and inform the citizens and the state about the current developments. Contribute to the utilization of the findings of the geological research and the possibilities of the geological sciences for economic development in relation to the social progress, the protection of the environment, and the improvement of quality of life. I take the opportunity to draw your attention about the upcoming 16th International Congress of the Geological Society that will be held in the city of Patras from the Department of Geology next year, 2022, which will begin on May 23rd. The Congress tagline is entitled Our Earth, Our Home, and aims to bring together academics, researchers, research students, and industry from around the world to share their knowledge, experience, and research results on all aspects of geosciences. We will be delighted to host you there. Before closing, I would like to thank you once again for your presence and participation, and to wish you a stimulating, enlightening, and fruitful conference. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kouzoubidis. I think your English accent has made you the first candidate of taking my place in the next conference, hopefully. Okay, no. Now we move on to our next speaker, is Mr. Stefan Berg, who is the chairman of Promethea Association.
Mr. Chairman, dear colleagues and friends, ladies and gentlemen, I'm very pleased to be here today for the beginning of this conference. And physically, I know it was really a challenge to organize this conference in such a year. And I'm very happy that after about 18 months without traveling, my first professional trip is here together with you to support this conference with our Promethea Association. So Promethea is a non-profit association established in Belgium. And as you can read on this slide, Promethea promotes mineral processing and extractive metallurgy for mining and recycling. And everything I've heard today is fully online with the strategy and the objectives of the associations. And we are then therefore very happy to be a platinum sponsor of this conference. I don't know if it's possible to click on the link. There is a short movie, if it works, and then put it in a full screen, if possible. And then with this, we will save a lot of time. If you can. Yes, no. Yeah. Yeah. In between, I will just present briefly the association. It will be done. So I'm the chairman of this association. Our president is Professor Andrew Schmieras from the Non-Metal Ferrous Institute. So we change our president mainly every 4 years. And our vice president is Mrs. Marion Lenoir from RawMat, the French mining industry, mainly based on nickel. And then we have many other members. Okay. Ah, okay, great. Perfect. So you will have the opportunity again to see this movie all along the conference on the screens. So what do we do? The first objective of the association is really to build a strong partnership, to help our members to build projects, to help us to meet and exchange. We have also a big activity to promote piloting facilities and pilot demonstration. We also propose services of open innovation for our members, but not only, and we supported RawMat 2 years ago. We organize a lot of events for the young generation, scientific seminars, webinars, technical tools. I will come back on this. And of course, we represent the members' interest in front of the main European organizations, EIT Raw Materials, DG Grow, and different ministries when needed. And we have today more than 40 members. So, of course, you can join the association when you want, if you belong to the different categories that on which I will come back. Okay. So back to my slides, please. Perfect, or not. Can you switch to the next slide? The idea of the movie. Yeah, so I already introduced you the board of the association. So we have also an executive committee with the members that are mentioned here and that work with us all along the year to implement our research program. This was in the movie. I will not come back on this. We are really a go-between between our members, between their projects, between the European organization. We have already more than 40 members, as I told you. So just here to mention some Greek colleagues, Admiris here with Tassos, that is among us. And of course, NTUA, that even was of the founding member of the association. We have four main services that we offer to our members. So the R&D, organizing scientific seminars, helping them to build projects. In terms of pilots, you know that now when you build an EU project, having pilots involved for demonstration is key. And most of the EU pilots for mineral processing and extractive metallurgy are in the association, and they can help you also to build the best projects. Education and training is key. I mentioned it. We have a lot of young engineers, young technicians, even students among our members, and we organize every year, but last year, a tech tour with field trips where they can meet industries, SMEs, universities also, and exchange with people and build their own network as soon as possible. So these are some pictures of the tech tour. So sometimes it deals with mining, sometimes with recycling, and next year or this year it will be mining again. Promesha is involved in EU projects, so we were at the initiative of the MSP Refram project that worked on the value chains of refractory metals, and also at the origin of the European Expert on Critical Raw Materials. It's a screen. Now we are under screen two, but we still mention screen, and I will have the opportunity to come back more in the details on screen tomorrow in the parallel sessions. Also to announce our next scientific seminar, also physical seminar, hopefully. It will be in Sevilla, Spain, from the 1st to the 3rd of December 2021, right after the tech tour. And this year, in this seminar, therefore, we will give the floor to the young generation, and they will present their work to everybody that will attend physically, but also will propose remote action. The Promesha seminar is an open seminar. It's not restricted to the members, so do not hesitate to get more information on our website. And just to conclude, some keywords that really define the association. Most of these keywords were already pronounced today. I will not come back on them. Hopefully, we will have the opportunity to discuss later on in the exhibition and in the networking time. And thank you very much, and a fruitful and successful conference.
Thank you very much, Mr. Burke. Now I would like to call to the stage Mr. Ioannis Kanahoridis, who is the Health, Safety, Environment and Continuous Improvement Director of Mytilineos Metallurgical Business Unit.
Hi, everybody. Mytilineos is always thrilled to be a member of the GRawMat Innovation Group and, of course, support and participate in this milestone conference. Today, together, in the next 15 minutes, we will deep dive in Mytilineos and sustainability, starting from Mytilineos SA, going to the metallurgy business unit, and following to the Aluminium of Greece industrial complex. Just some words for the group. So we have a strong international presence, over five continents, over 30 countries, 3,850 employees, over 9,500 contractors, and 45% of our revenues coming from abroad. Well, you can see the key financial figures for 2020 in this table. So, how was our businesses built? So, firstly, we have a very strong commitment in ESG and, of course, health and safety, which is the S of ESG. We have a diverse business mix, and I will talk to you in a while about it, and of course, having synergies between these diversified business units in order to have a strong result. We have a low-cost structure, which is a very strong competitive advantage for us, a broad international reach, strong financial profile, and, of course, the experience management behind it in order to support all this effort. So we have four business units, which is the power and gas, metallurgy, R&D, and sustainable engineering solutions. So I will leave metallurgy because I will explain more in a while. So power and gas, maybe you know it under Protergia, which is the trade name, and has to do with energy production. And we're aiming to have an exceed capacity of 2.3 gigawatts by the end of the year. And of course, being the first and the largest domestic private natural gas importer in the SLNG. So the RSD is a new department, so it comes from the split up of METCA, who was the construction department. And now we have a development of solar solutions, reliable solutions and BOTs. And finally, we have the sustainable engineering solution dealing with the sustainability projects and the built up of energy stations, and recently going also to waste treatment. So By following now, going deep diving a bit to sustainability, we're completely dedicated to the European Green Deal. So, and we can see in figures that we also doubled our green EBITDA. So we're very, very into this. And also, we're having strong engagement for the green future in the decarbonization projects, having very strong targets by for decreasing by 30% our carbon footprint by 2030 and going net zero by 2050. And also, you can see the targets for each business unit. Also, we're completely dedicated to sustainability. So, as supporters, signatories, members, and volunteers, we're in Sustainable Development Goals of the United Nations, the Global Compact of United Nations also, the ESI initiative, and the CDP. Now, going to the metallurgy business unit, so the metallurgy business unit consists of the aluminum of Greece, Delphi Distomo Mining, and Epalmi. So leaving again aluminum of Greece at the side because we're gonna further deep dive in a while. Just for Delphi Distomo, a few words. So it's the second biggest miner company of bauxite in Greece with a capacity of over 570,000 tons per year and over 230 employees. And Epalmi, so it's a new member of the company. So we have aluminum recycling. Their actual capacity today is 35,000 tons and 77 employees. And now going to Aluminium of Greece, which is the core, I would say, of the metallurgy business unit. So just in a few figures, so we have more than 1,500 direct and indirect employees. And we have active presence in more than 20 countries. So our long history starts in 1963 with the construction of the plant till 1966. We have the startup in 1966. Afterwards, we have 30 years of development where we doubled our production capacity. We have the acquisition by the Alcan Group in 2003 because at the time we were passionate. And afterwards, 2005, also an important milestone as we were acquired by Mytilineos Group. After that, we have heavy investments for 5 years in order to keep the business running. And following that, we have a lot of cost cutting and improvement projects in order to succeed in having the position that we have today among the 25% of the most cost-effective plants in the world, despite of our age. Another important milestone is on July 2017, we became one company. And this is why now we're referring as Mytilineos. So this is Aluminium of Greece with the alumina, aluminium plant and the facilities. Okay, and I will tell you a bit more about the facilities in the next slide. So for aluminium, as we deep dive a bit longer, so we produce 182,000 tons of primary aluminium, meaning coming from electrolysis. And also we have in support under production of 94,000 tons per year. In the cast house, we can produce 120 tons of aluminium in billets and 70,000 tons in slab. And also we have a big residue storage facility for the bauxite residues where we have stored till today 7.5 million tons. And so this becomes a very important project for us in order to valorize this new raw material, I would say. And also, just next to us, we have the cogeneration plant, the CHP, where we get steam for our alumina production. Also, we have a port, which is the fifth bigger in bulk cargoes in Greece, so accepting 430 vessels per year of raw materials. And you can see unloading and also loading our products to our clients. And you can see also the quantities that we unload and load per year. So now going to the raw material. So the major raw material for us is bauxite. You can see that most of it is coming from Greece. As we said earlier on, we're among the 10 countries in bauxite reduce, in bauxite, sorry, stock. And also we have a quantity of 400,000 tons coming from abroad, what we call tropical bauxite, especially from Africa and Brazil. So our products is 840,000 tons of alumina. So more or less half of it is sold as hydrated or anhydrous alumina, and the rest of it is transferred to aluminium in our smelter installations. So our outcome is 190,000 tons, so it's 182 coming from electrolysis, plus 7,000 is recycled, okay? And in order to produce the products that I told you earlier on, with 105,000 tons exported, and the rest, 85,000 tons sold in the green market. So concerning our health and safety policy, it's our top priority, I would say. It's a long year ago that we started seeing, let's say, focusing on health and safety. It was in 1998 and even before that. So you can see how we decreased the lost time injuries. Of course, safety is a continuous fight, and no one can say that the results are there to stay. So this is an effort ongoing every day. Also, as I told you earlier on, Mytilineos heavily invested in order to be able to continue working, operating. So we have, at the end, the two big investments in the cast house in order to have state-of-the-art products, meaning wax stuff, billets, and slabs. We have the CHP for the steam production. We have the filter presses in order to take out the bauxite residues from the sea and take it to landfill. A new flash kiln, also in the alumina sector, and lately we have also filters for the anode department, and we are now in a while passing from crude oil to natural gas in 100% of the plant. So again, sustainability. So we have a special department called RSD, Research and Sustainable Development, dealing with 23 European projects, and you can see that we're trying to valorize most of our wastes, I would say, but also working on education and training, waste to power, aluminium recycling. We have two installations, one pyro and one hydro metallurgy unit, and also we have an ICP instrumentation in order to do all the required analysis. Also, for the bauxite residue valorization, Mr. Thimis Balomenos will give you a presentation in the next days how we try to extract scandium from bauxite residues, so going to circularity. So, as I told you earlier on, we have strong initiatives in order to go green, to decarbonize our production. So you can see this is specific for aluminum of Greece. So we want to decrease by 65% the total CO2 emissions, and if we take it per ton of aluminium, this is translated to 75% of reduction. And these are the main pillars, and in the middle, we have the new technology where we have the digitalization, where we have the first digital smelter in the world. And we're very proud of it. Several awards on health and safety, human resources, and waste management from 2017 till today. The new ones, I would say, and also the required certifications on health and safety, environment, quality, and the laboratory for all the analysis done. Finally, just to conclude and give a big picture, we have also White Houses, Aspraspitia in Greece, so where we accommodate our people, our employees. So we're talking about 1,072 buildings, residences, and we have a population of over 3,000 people. In the next slide, of course, you can follow us in the social media, and I will be more than happy to have a talk with you on all of this. Just by ending, I want to say that despite all this, we're staying humble. We are a humble company. We understand that the challenge is enormous, and we can only solve it by participating and by partnering with you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Karanahoridis. Now I would like to call to the stage Mr. Panos Lolos, who is the General Manager, Copper and Alloys Extrusion Division of Elval-Halkor Hellenic Copper and Aluminium Industry. Mr. Lolos, the stage is yours.
Dear President of the Organizing Committee, dear President of the Scientific Committee, dear Dean, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. I would like to say that the Greek metallurgical sector has been a driving force for the Greek economy, not just because of the contribution of this sector to the Greek GDP. I can briefly mention that more than 8% of the added value which is produced by the Greek metallurgical sector is invested per year in Greece. Also, 22% of the Greek exports, excluding the petrochemical products, are being exported from the Greek metallurgical sector. The metallurgical sector of copper and aluminium in particular exports more than 6% of the Greek exports, it's very close to 7%, and invests more than 6% of the turnover yearly, 6% of the value added produced by this sector in Greece. So that creates an added value of around 687 million per annum. Now, the investments on those two basic metals, copper and aluminium, create a value of more than 21% of the gross added value. And we have to say that the average of the investments based on the gross added value per year in Greece in the heavy industry is 17.5%. So you can understand that the contribution is much higher. And this industry is investing more than the others in this sector. Whereas, in the Greek financial records, we can find out that the average of the investments is very close to 14%. So that the heavy industry invests, and the industry of copper and aluminum invests heavily. Another important thing with our sector has to do with the research and investment. We know that the investment in Greece yearly is about 6,000 euros per capita, whereas in the heavy industry is 36,000 euros per capita. And we have to monitor that this figure can be recorded also during the years after the crisis of 2010. So the message here is that the Greek heavy industry, the Greek metallurgical industry, and the copper and aluminium sector in particular is still investing in this country. Now, if we consider that the exports, as I mentioned before, of our products are almost 7% of the Greek exports, excluding the petrochemicals, of course, you can understand how important this sector is for the Greek economy. According to the data of the Hellenic Aluminium Association, more than 16.5 thousand people are working for this industry in Greece directly, and 80,000 people indirectly. Another important thing is that this is the aluminium sector, the second best in terms of turnover export industry in Greece. and that represents approximately 1.7 billion of turnover per annum. So we have to say also that the copper and the aluminium sector of Greece are very dynamic, but are contributing substantially to the Greek economy because they pay much better than any other sector of the economy. It is also important to say that is a driving force for the Greek economy because there is a lot of attention to the health and safety issue, as we heard before from the Mytilineos group, to the supporting the environmental standards, and also to the corporate governance. Now, Elval Halkor, since 2017, is the most well-known copper and aluminium industry in Greece and one of the biggest in Europe. We produce copper and aluminium products for more than 50 countries to all over the world. We employ more than 2,000 people directly in our facilities. And we also have a strong financial footprint in four different countries, with a turnover of more than 2.2 billion euros per annum. It is also important to say that Elval Halkor is strongly committed to many dynamic applications, so is strongly committed to serve many dynamic applications like the shipping industry, like the automotive, like the heating, ventilation, air conditioning and refrigeration industry, and like other industrial and mechanical applications. It is also important to say that our company invested in the last 3 years more than 295 million euros towards expanding our capacity and towards improving the portfolio of our products. We invested towards increasing the capacity of our copper tube mill in Inofyta, which is the biggest in Europe, Middle East, and Africa, by 5,000 tons. And we also made a very important investment, which is ongoing right now. The first stage was about 150 million euros for installing a hot roll mill in Inofyta. And the second phase of the investment, which is ongoing right now, is going to bring to Elval Halkor an overall capacity of up to 500,000 tons by 2024, making Elval Halkor a leader also in the production of aluminium roll products in Europe. Now, the nature of the metallurgical sector, as you all know, and especially of the basic metals like copper and aluminium, is really strongly related with the circular economy. Both of those metals can be recycled fully with safety for the final consumers. It is also important to say that by lowering the environmental and the energy footprint of our products, we have a considerable comparative advantage towards our competitors. It is important to say that according to the European Aluminium Association, about 75% of the cans that we use for our beers or our Coke are being recycled per year, and this target by the end of 2030 is 100% of that product to be recycled. We can see the same figures more or less in Greece. We can also say that according to the international available data, 75% of all our waste that we recycle in Europe comes from the metal products. And the rest is public, different products like paper, textiles, etc. It is also important to say that according to the mega trends that we have, the world won't, like urbanization, climate change, the need to have more green energy or to produce more energy from different resources is also driving our business because our customers and the applications that our customers are positioned are making important for us to produce by lowering the footprint that we have both from the energy and the environmental point of view. As you know, and as Professor Xenidis said earlier today, it is for sure that the car industry, for example, in the next few years is going to ask for four times or up to four times more copper. And frankly speaking, we have the production in Sofiamed in Bulgaria where we produce copper for connectors which are suitable for the new electric cars in order to follow the mega trend of the e-mobility. It is also important to say that for the future of the metallurgical sector in Greece, it is important to accept or to follow two new principles. The first one has to do, both of them technological. The first one has to do with the separation of metals, especially metals and alloys. And when we talk about separation, we talk about even the PPMs, which are necessary. And the second has to do with the capacity we have to re-elaborate the metals again. So it is not only important to increase the recycle rate, and it is right now very important. In copper, we recycle more than, or we base our production more than two-thirds, more than 70% on recycled resources. And the aluminum sector is following the same trend. But it is also important to say that the separation is a difficult task. However, we have invested a lot towards that dimension, especially an automated separation. As far as the re-elaboration is concerned, the recycled metal, there is a lot of work that has to be done with respect to the pyrometallurgical methods. Ladies and gentlemen, the heavy industry is really important, as I said before, for the Greek economy. It is very important to say that 40% of the taxation of this country is coming from the heavy industry. It is also important to say that 87% of the exports is coming from the industrial products that we produce. And it is also important to say that according to IOVE, the Foundation for Economic and Industrial Research here in Greece, for any single euro that we invest in the heavy industry, the economy can produce 3.2 euros. So that means that if we have the chance to return back to the GDP contribution of 1995, which was around 11.5%, from the 9%, which is approximately now, we would have a chance to create 500,000 jobs. And that would be a GDP contribution, as I said before, of 11.5%. So that means more revenues for the government of about 4.5 billion euros. It is also important to say that the Greek industry has been very resilient in the years after 2010. As an example, during the years 2009 until 2018, we managed not only to keep the production rate and the capacity fixed, but we also managed through investments that we overtook as a heavy industry to increase more than any other sector of the Greek economy. Even in the last 2 years, 3 years, from 2018 to 2020, when the production index of this country was increased to the 105 base points, the industrial index of the copper and aluminum industry went up to the 122 base points. So that means an increase which is much better than any other industrial sector. It is also important to say that the future of the Greek metallurgical sector and the future of the Greek manufacturing is strongly related with the future of the industrial manufacturing in Europe. There was a discussion before about the scarcity of raw material. Professor Xenidis mentioned the data from the OECD. Indeed, we're going to have the double need in the next few decades. This is true. And this is also true that has been working a lot the EU officials. We know that in the last few years, there is a new agenda in Europe and a new strategy with respect to the industrial, the manufacturing future of Europe. And that was recently updated because of the implications of the pandemic and the disruption in the supply chain network, the world supply chain network, which has to do also with the shipping. So that means that the EU understands that we have to lower dependency from imports from third countries, and especially from countries where any dependence can create certain political implications. And it is also true that we have to go towards a more green and a more agile manufacturing. It is also true that in the last discussion in Europe, which had as a result the update of the agenda with respect to the manufacturing in Europe, there was a lot of attention to the green and to the digital economy, which is one of our concerns as a heavy industry. Greece cannot stay away from this discussion. The industrial growth of this country is and should be a national case for everybody, without preconceptions and without biases for the heavy industry. It is also important to say that there is a given target with respect to the future of the manufacturing in Greece. We know that we want to go from 9 to 12% as a contribution to our GDP by 2025, and want to increase that up to 15% within the next 15 years. And this is a target that has been accepted also by the government and by all associations representing the Greek heavy industry. It is also important to say that the new established by the government committee for the heavy industry, in order to shape the new industrial strategy, has to take into consideration very seriously the need to have an overall waste policy with respect to recycle, especially with respect to the domestic raw materials and the waste. And I was very glad to hear the delegate of the Technical Chamber of Greece today discussing about that. It is also important to say that this discussion and the new strategy has to take place, has also to take into consideration the need for lower dependency by incomes, by imports, as I said before, the need to go towards a zero waste economy, and the need also to have an harmonized industrial symbiosis, which is really important, especially in areas where the heavy industry has not been developed in the last few decades with a structured way. It is also important to say that we have to take into consideration the need to have an added value in our industry, starting from the extraction until the production of final goods, final industrial goods for our customers. Elval Halkor has done a lot of work towards achieving those targets, and it's also important to say that Elval Halkor is driving the discussion in many cases, not only to the benefit of our customers, but also to the benefit of our stakeholders, the local society, and everybody who is related with our business. It is important to say that everything that has to take place in the future with respect to the heavy industry in Greece has to take place under the principle of the sustainability. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for the chance I had to address this Congress today. I congratulate again the organizing committee and the scientific committee for organizing this event, and I wish you all the best and the best of the success in your discussion. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Lolos. Now it's time for our first plenary lecture, entitled The European Mining Sector, Contributing to Our Third Priorities. Speaker will be Mr. Mark Rachovidis, who is the president of Euromines.
Good evening, Professor. Good evening, everybody. I hope that this is coming through clearly. Yes.
If I may, I'll go straight ahead. I enjoyed the last presentation. I just wonder what I'm going to say now. The previous speaker covered very many very important points. But what I find very interesting is our industry needs to be even better at communicating. Our main challenge is to communicate with people outside our industry. We're very good at speaking to each other. But I read an article which disturbed me last week in the New York Times talking about Greece, which made all sorts of very easy connections between political beliefs, industrial practices, government policies, etc. And our industry and heavy industry as a whole came off very badly in that article. And it seems very easy to make negative conclusions about our industry, both in Greece and throughout Europe. And what we really need to do as an industry is really show our stakeholders, our customers, our neighbors, our friends, what we do. I'm going to share my screen with you now and go through a brief presentation, if I may. I hope that is working. I apologize. That's better. Ladies and gentlemen, Euromines, is for those of you who may not have met us, is the representative body for the European mining industries. We are the recognized counterparty for the industry. We represent companies ranging in size from the largest companies of Europe, LKAB, Boliden, KGHM of Poland, and others, to mining associations whose members will include both large companies and small developing companies. We have one indirect member that has two employees. We have others that have tens of thousands of employees. We speak for the industry throughout. We work with our friends in the metal sectors. We work with specialist groups. We work internationally with other associations. We're part of the business advisory group of the OECD. We work with the European Commission on numerous projects, and with many of the speakers who've already spent time with you this evening. So I hope that qualifies us to talk in a slightly more general way about what the European mining sector can contribute to our future. Our immediate concern is, of course, to deal with what faces us all today. That is to recover from the pandemic. Clearly, we know that our industry plays a vastly important role in supplying its products to European manufacturing and other downstream users. Several speakers already mentioned supply chain difficulties. I have an English accent. The country of my birth is having tremendous supply chain difficulties at the moment because it's very over-reliant upon imports. The pandemic has also underlined the crucial role, the importance of the pharmaceutical, the medical, and the chemical sectors, all of which are entirely dependent on raw materials, some of which we produce. Therefore, what we do as the European mining industry is essential for European value chains, and therefore crucial to overcome the crisis that we all face because of the pandemic. Going forward, we can talk about the past, but it's much better to talk about tomorrow. There is a blueprint, a green print, if you like, for the future of the European Union and its citizens. But how we build that future is entirely dependent upon raw materials. Raw materials, as you know, provide everything we use, from modern technology to established technology, to new things to old things. And the demand for those raw materials is continuously increasing in Europe and worldwide. Competition is increasing worldwide. Everybody who works in Europe, who believes in developing a sustainable Europe, relies upon metal minerals. European companies are global leaders in innovation. A very good example of that is the Canada project.
Mr. Rachovidis, sorry for interrupting you, but as far as I know, you have a PowerPoint presentation, but we cannot see that. You have not properly shared your PowerPoint presentation. Please check it.
Yes, it's being disabled by the host. I can see. It's not. I already pressed the button. The host needs to enable it. I see what the problem is.
Okay, please proceed.
Yeah, I. Is that better? Can you see it now?
Now it is okay.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, I'm sorry. I was unaware that you were not seeing the presentation. I was mentioning that European companies are global leaders in innovation. We were very happy to be one of the rapporteurs for the EU-Canada natural resources chapter. The EU and Canada have a very well-known trade agreement, the CETA, the CETA. The only industry that has a specific provision for it is natural resources. And we participate with the Mining Association of Canada and the two governments in a dialogue in terms of how we develop mutual cooperation in natural resources. In order to do that, of course, we had to understand what the position was. And whilst, of course, Canada is a very large exporter of raw materials and natural resources, the flow of innovation, the flow of services, the flow of machinery, the flow of knowledge is very much the other way. We provide 10 times what the Canadians do in terms of mining services, mining technology, mining consultancy, mining information, and so forth. One of the reasons we do that is because the European mining industry delivers its performance to the highest standards, not because it's only imposed upon us by the governments, and by that I mean the European Unions and the member states, but also because it has become a unique selling point. If we want to talk about sustainable materials, we need to show that sustainable raw materials can be demonstrated. We can only do that through the highest standards. Delivering those standards is to everybody's advantage. It is a competitive advantage for European companies. I hope that allows us to claim some leadership in fighting climate change. In very simple terms, the higher the climate targets, the more metals and minerals are needed for the clean energy transition. As an industry, we've made incredible progress in terms of reducing our CO2 emissions, in terms of improving our productivity, our resource and energy efficiency, and we continue to employ this human capital, these solutions to move ever forward. As the previous speakers have said, Europe has become very dependent upon highly specialized metals and alloys that require minerals and metals, some of which are not produced in Europe, but many are essential to what we need to deliver climate neutrality by 2050. In Europe, there is a significant amount of exploration and a significant amount of development for these rare earth projects. I could spend a lot of time talking about this, but we have the ability, we have the resources, we have the government support, we have the capital to move this ahead and to become much, much more self-sufficient in a reasonable time horizon. We need to work with our friends and our partners, people who share our values, the Canadians, the Australians, South Americans, Japanese, Koreans, others, in order to bridge that gap. There are political issues, as the previous speaker rightly said, but with the standards that we demonstrate already, we will overcome these issues together. Digital sovereignty was also mentioned by previous speakers. It is a priority. The picture there is a very common image. I don't know if you can see that. That's better. It's a control room image from one of our members, Agnico Eagle in Finland, but it could be the Chelopech mine in Bulgaria. A modern mind today relies completely upon digitalization for control and delivery of its performance. We have critical dependence, not only in mining, but in so many industries, on electronics. And we're therefore dependent on the raw materials we need to make them. Our industry innovates, as I've already said, for sustainable products, for sustainable development. We need sustainably mined metals and minerals. What we're doing is working with other industries, for example, looking at logistics, looking at supply chains, looking at control mechanisms, deployment of blockchain technology, for example. We're looking for synergies with other industries to improve material flows and increase our added value. Sorry, my screen has jammed, I apologize, that's better. We all know that one of the central pillars of European policy is to make our economy more resilient and robust. That's better. One of the ways of doing that is to increase our domestic production of minerals. And therefore we become obviously less dependent on foreign sources and we improve our sustainable supply chain. We do have our own raw materials. It's not true to say that there are not viable world-class deposits within Europe. There certainly are within Greece. There certainly are within so many countries. But we can only improve our sustainability and our well-being through the innovations that we're good at and through better application. Our industry does that, but we must mitigate our supply risk by providing the right materials. We must look at secondary mining as well. I'm told, I don't know if this figure is correct, and I do a lot of work to try and ascertain the truth. I'm told there are something like 7,000 secondary mining sites, potential secondary mining sites within the European Union. There's certainly many in Greece today. There are, I would say, many hundreds in the Balkans. What we need is to have a green, sustainable, circular, and low carbon technologies. We need sustainable agriculture and resilient value chains. We can do that with some recycling, with some secondary production, more than we do today. We can deploy the industry's knowledge, technology, and most importantly, standards to those secondary projects. But demand, as very well expressed by the previous speaker, is far greater and will become even greater, and competition will become even greater as we go through this decade. We cannot ignore primary production in Europe, and we cannot ignore trade with our friends. We need to defend our common values and strengthen our democratic model. We know that. This is one of the central pillars of European policy. We work as mining companies in Europe with local communities, increasingly. Some people talk about a social license to operate, but increasingly our members work together to develop strategies for long-term sustainability. Our projects are 25 years old, some in many cases, many more. Many projects exist, for example, in Scandinavia that would not exist in North America, South Africa, Australia, and so forth, because there is a long-term commitment to sustainable development, which is now today also profitable. We collect data, we work with partners, as I've already said, we work with other industries, and that helps local populations. It helps to shine light on local difficulties and find solutions. Responsible stewardship, responsible behavior is much more than simply conforming to a permit. It is about understanding that profit is not just expressed as money. Social responsibility has been and always will be a central part of what we do. It's part of sustainable development by any mining company today. The EU must strengthen its role as a global actor. I think this is my final slide. We all know that. We know that the world is changing rapidly. The demographics in the world are changing rapidly. The financial balance in the world is changing rapidly. The balance of power in the world is changing rapidly. And the European mining sector is among the most sophisticated partners. The, that the European member states and the European Union has in addressing all of these challenges. We work together to share our experiences. We work together to develop further engagement in order to have sustainable development. We work together not only with ourselves, but we work together with our customers, with our suppliers, with our employees, with our neighbors, with our competitors, to deliver the 17 goals set out by the United Nations in its sustainable development agenda. We have the same goals as everyone else. We are and will remain a world leader in sustainable raw materials production. That is our main contribution. We need to do more. As I said at the beginning of this presentation, we need to do more to tell people what we do. It's very sad that still today, so many people have not only wrong, but outdated impressions of our industry. Our industry is an industry of the future. European mining is not something in the past. It's very much something that our children and grandchildren will enjoy, contribute to, and understand, I hope, better than people today. Ladies and gentlemen, those are our contact details. Thank you for listening to me. I hope I haven't delayed you from your drinks too much. And I thank you for your time, and I wish you a very, very successful conference. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rachovidis. These are plenary lectures, so if there are any questions to Mr. Rachovidis, is there anyone who wants to ask something? So, thank you very much, Mr. Rachovidis. We'll proceed to the last plenary lecture, will be given by Mr. Kremlis. Thank you very much, Mr. Kremlis, for accepting our invitation to give a plenary lecture. The stage is yours.
The pleasure is mine. Thank you very much for your invitation, and congratulations for this very important and timely conference on raw materials, a very important theme in relation to a circular economy and the new priorities of the European Union. We are currently facing the new challenge, which is climate crisis. The European Union has developed a climate law under the Green Deal and a set of rules that the European Commission has proposed to implement the Green Deal and the climate law, which are related to carbon neutrality by 2050 with an intermediate target by 2030 for a 55% reduction of the emissions compared to the 1990 emissions state of emissions. This is an extremely important process which influences all the sectors of activity, and in particular the raw material sector, the extraction activities, mining, and all the other related activities. It influences our behavior as human beings, as well as the activities of the companies and the private businesses which have to develop environmental and social governance schemes. And I would add to this circular environmental and social governance, as this is now the new motto that we all have to develop. It is very important in this three pillars priorities of the European Union, namely green growth, a growth that is extremely important as it leads to a higher GDP, but also to jobs, which are extremely important to develop green and promote green jobs. And this green growth is in line, has to be in line with the taxonomy regulation. In other words, only investments that have a low environmental footprint and are compliant with the environmental acquis of the Union and the EU policy priorities are eligible for financing. This is extremely important, and this is something that will affect several sectors of our economy. Next to the green growth, we have the blue growth. It is also extremely important as it concerns all the activities in the seas and the oceans, but also in the extraction, hydrocarbon, and other mineral activities that can be developed in the seabed. It is also very important that the blue economy is in line with the taxonomy regulation when it comes to financings. And last but not least, the digital economy, which is key and which needs to be mainstreamed both in the green growth and in the blue economy. And of course, on the top of all that, we have the circular economy, the new emblematic priority of the European Union, which is the new economic model that we will have to promote worldwide. The European Union is promoting this not only within the 27 member states, but also in the neighborhood policy and beyond, as only through the circular economy we will be able to combat the climate crisis and to save our planet, which suffers currently from unsustainable production and consumption patterns. And this concerns also, as a matter of priority, the raw materials and the critical raw materials, which start to becoming more and more precious. You are all aware of the raw materials initiatives. 78 raw materials have been evaluated with fact sheets, which are available, and the revised methodology. We have the Commission communication on the 27 critical raw materials. It's the communication 2017/490. And then an important report on the critical raw materials and the circular economy, a very important link between the two, of January 2018. This is the Commission staff document 2018/36 final. This is a very important report which aims to ensure a coherent and effective EU approach to critical raw materials in the transition to a circular and low carbon economy with an increased circularity of critical raw materials. And of course, the purpose is to help the member states to implement the new provisions on critical raw materials in the Waste Framework Directive. For your information, recently Greece has adopted the law which transposes in the Greek legal order the Waste Framework Directive of 2018, which revises and codifies the 2008 Waste Framework Directive. A very important piece of legislation which promotes circular economy, recycling economic instruments and, of course, implement the high recycling objectives which are set by the so-called circular economy waste directives, mainly that we have to ensure recycling up to 65% by 2035 and reduce landfilling to 10%. And of course, as regards waste to energy, which is important, limit this only to non-recyclable waste, as waste has to be recycled, sorted out and recycled, and the remainder only could be incinerated. And of course, a very important thing is that this new piece of legislation foresees the so-called system of endiodosia, which is that when you buy something, you pay a fee, which is reimbursed when you bring back the container. The acronym in English is DRS, Deposit and Refund Scheme. An important piece of legislation, which of course does not interfere with the mining directive, the directive which entered into application in 2008 and which was transposed in the Greek legal order. Mining waste is not covered by this new ambitious piece of legislation. A very important piece of legislation, which covers, of course, all the other waste streams, with the exclusion of mining waste. Now, what is extremely important when it comes also to raw materials and to the mining industry is the end of waste criteria. We have three end of waste regulations, which are based on JRC reports, one on ferrous and aluminium scrap, the other on copper and copper alloy scrap, and the third one on waste glass, which is glass cullet. The JRC has also developed an EU reference document for the management of waste from extractive industries to help the environmental authorities when setting permit conditions for extractive waste facilities to ensure safety and lower environmental footprint. This is extremely important, as the aim of this mining directive, extractive waste directive, is to reduce the environmental impacts throughout the whole process of the mining and also the management of the mining waste. And in that respect, as Mr. Rachovidis has also mentioned, mining waste is not, although in some cases it can be dangerous, is not to be considered in this new era of circular economy as waste that has to be landfilled or disposed in a dangerous landfill facility. Mining waste can be extremely... Mining waste can have can be considered as raw material or secondary product, and can be further processed or reused both in the production of clinker, cement, or in the building sector, as well as in other sectors, as technology and eco-innovation and now has developed in a way that even dangerous waste can be managed and treated and can lead to raw materials or secondary products that can be reintroduced in the economy. And this is extremely important to keep in mind and to take into consideration when it comes to the various types of mining waste, rock, for example, or other types of mining waste. Now, to conclude, as circular economy is mainstreamed in all the other sectors of the economy with the view to making them circular, and one could speak about circular agriculture, circular tourism, circular transport, with the aim to reduce their environmental, energy, and climate footprint, it is extremely important to develop circular mining and circular extractive activities from A to Z, from the extraction process till the waste management and, of course, the rehabilitation. And here in Greece, and this is very important, we are one the unique country compared to others, phasing out from lignite much earlier than the other EU member states, namely by 2023 for the four municipalities in Western Macedonia and for the fifth in Megalopolis by 2028. This is a very ambitious phasing out program from lignite, which of course is accompanied and supported by the Just Transition Fund in the context of the New Generation EU, will be also supported by the Recovery and the Resilience Plan with the view to create new jobs where there will be losses of jobs because of the stopping of the lignite extraction. Rehabilitation of the mines is extremely important. And of course, what is extremely important is to see how the mining activities in these areas can be replaced by other activities which will be in line with the energy transition and the national program on energy and climate of Greece, which is one of the most ambitious ones and which will be updated to become even more ambitious in the light of the new pieces of legislation and the new proposals that have been proposed by the European Commission. So the last word is how raw materials, extraction, manufacturing, new products, sustainable production and consumption patterns can be developed, and how we can reduce the environmental, the climate, and the energy footprint of those activities covered by your important conference with the view to making them circular. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kramlis, for a very solid and, I would say, enlightening lecture. I don't know if you have any questions from our audience or from our virtual attendees. Okay, we have no questions. Thank you very much and good night.
Please note that there is a welcome reception upstairs at the 8th floor, as far as I remember. You are invited, all of you, to join us.